This video contains strong opinions in regards to the 2019 CW's Nancy Drew television adaptation. All voiced opinions are personal and shared from a beloved fan of the original material. No severe hate is being held or sent to anyone involved in the making of this show. This is merely my personal opinion of the series and changes I might have made. Please enjoy. The intro to the 11th episode of the series opens into another steamy dream sesh of Nancy's, another unnecessary sexual pushing and love triangle. Fun, but gotta love it. Snap back to reality, and Nancy finds her mom's guidance counselor stuff, rifling through it to look for Lucy Sable's file, only to find someone has already stolen the contents of it. Nancy meets up with Carson to make sure he's still alive and managing okay in prison, as well as to get info on Lucy's file contents and why they're missing. Fingers immediately pointing to Everett Hudson. Funny how the show is so fine talking about him, but the Hudsons and the Marvins, aside from the young hunks of the family, are never really seen all that much. Although that will change in this episode, well, for a time. We get info from Bess that we're finally going to meet more of the Marvins, as she'll be having dinner with her Aunt Diana, who ironically is the one she's supposed to be pretending to live with this whole time. Spiritual Bess is super excited for this.
Oh, Owen called. I'm having lunch with Aunt Diana today.
Going full Marvin. Congratulations.
I know. It's exactly how I manifested it.
We also come to meet the owner of the Claw. Again, I can't even remember if she was previously introduced in the show because it's so all over the place, but she breaks George's heart and tells her that she plans on selling the place. Just as George's heart is breaking over the possible loss of the Claw, Nick is ruminating with some random man about his family back in Florida and how he's the black sheep who won't amount to anything, but it appears an idea has struck. And given how transparent this writing and editing is, we all know what he plans on doing. I mean, the man's got millions of dollars now, don't forget. We get a quick special appearance from Mr. Hudson as Nancy interrogates him further about Lucy. I once again don't understand how and why Carson would even initially get involved with these people. Carson's original character doesn't care much about money and family ties like that. He only cares for his family, justice, and the truth. And that Carson would never get into bed with these people. Just before leaving the Hudson house, Nancy gets another ghostly clue again, leading her to further evidence against the Hudsons. But we'll save that for later. Just know, I hate this find. Next, we get some romantic time with Bess and Lisbeth, as Bess finally decides to admit the truth of her life, now fully trusting Lisbeth with her previous reveal of her job description. And safe to say, Lisbeth loves the real Bess. The real British Bess.
It's an opportunity to embrace authenticity. Kind of a fan of the Brits, Bess, huh?
You sure?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, brother. Nancy and Bess trail Owen, and you're telling me the man didn't recognize this very obvious car that he knows Nancy drives? Come on! I would have preferred if they ended up meeting up, making a comedic moment of it, by Owen making a joke about how they were quite obvious and the car isn't all that conspicuous. But, okay, missed opportunity. Once they finally catch up to them, Bess starts asking the really important questions.
Why are you ducking my calls?
Yeah, is it another girl?
Yeah, that one. Owen, obviously still looking to prove the Hudson's involvement in the sinking of the Bonnie Scott, has tracked down the only surviving crew member of the vessel. Bashir, a man from Somalia who worked on the ship and is now haunted by the memories and trapped in the country that doesn't accept him without the appropriate paperwork. A subtle mention to the issues with immigration in the States, but this plot point is never really expanded on, and upon the conclusion of the storyline, Bashir isn't even seen or mentioned again. So much for helping him with his immigration status there, eh, Bess? As the romance between Owen and Nancy starts to creep in more, so does the romance brewing between George and Nick. I hate how the writers prefer to focus on romances in the story instead of driving the plot forward or helping to develop the characters more. Bess finally meets her Aunt Diana for the first time, and the meeting doesn't go quite as expected, with Diana laying out to Bess what it truly means to be a part of the founding family. Appearances to maintain, work with the town and their affiliated business, but the biggest point of contention is Bess's love for Lisbeth and her new family's disapproval for dating or marrying anyone below their standard. This message immediately digs into Bess's brain like a worm, infecting her feelings and thoughts as she desperately tries to fit in with her new family. We get another romantic moment between George and Nick with an almost kiss back at the Claw, only to be interrupted by, you guessed it, Miss Drew herself. This love triangle plot is really just too much too soon. But hey, teen drama, right? Nick ends up ditching George without even saying goodbye, leaving a hurt George to, as she puts it,
clams ready to shuck.
Guess I'll just shuck myself.
Ew. Back to see Bashir, Nick and Nancy see that Bashir is being realistically haunted by the memories of the ship. I'm not even going to try and rationalize or explain this because I just can't. Just know that apparently in this reality, hauntings can happen like this, and multiple people can experience the same haunting at the same time, somehow. Oh my god. Bashir reveals he had kept some metal from the ship he had used to protect himself, bomb fragments visible within the metal. Nancy obviously decides to use this to give to the police as further evidence to open an investigation against the sinking of the ship. We never end up seeing any of the giving of the evidence to the police. Instead, we flash back to a formal dinner party hosted at the Hudson's with all the relevant Hudson's and Marvin's in attendance, including Miss Bess. Though the party doesn't go on for quite that long until girlfriend Elizabeth shows up to save the day and arrest Everett Hudson. The final straw in his arrest being a wire transfer he sent to try and continue his cover-up, only to have it been foiled by the account being owned by the state police.
How could you let this happen?
I should have left after I found the proof of your affair with Sebastian.
Yeah, you should have. Why didn't you? Once Mr. Everett is out of the way and everyone is distracted, Nancy uses the info learned from her ghost friend earlier in the episode to find Lucy's file hidden under a painting by Everett. Well, glad we sold that in less than an episode. Nancy meets up with Owen outside of the party, and to distract him from asking why she's even there in the first place, she starts making out with him. Yeah, a great plan. Seemed to work, though, because a stunned Owen just stands there and lets her take off without any answers to any of his brewing questions. The episode rounds out with more romances, just like how we started. Lisbeth and Bess finally doing the deed. Oh la la. George and Nick conspire and romance further over the possible loss of the claw. And finally we see a shot of Bashir, free of the ghost now the case of the Bonnie Scott is solved. My last comments and thoughts I'll end this episode on are further disappointment with the writers with the use of Carson. He is a lawyer and knows everything about the law and his rights, yet he hasn't done anything to try and protect or defend himself, which Nancy lovingly points out to him. More disrespect! But hey, at least maybe we're going to get the Carson who will do anything to protect his daughter now. Yeah, I'm not so optimistic either. Episode 12 opens on Nancy thinking over the possibility of Lucy's own mother murdering her daughter. Oh yeah, forgot to mention that Nancy read that in a transcript of her mother's visits with Lucy from her school files. I didn't know this was a thing guidance counselors even did, but okay. Miss Drew kept nearly legal court transcripts on her appointments with all of her students. Huh, I guess it pays to be married to a lawyer. To get to the bottom of this mystery, Nancy first goes to see Josh Dodd to get info on where his mother is currently living. Josh tells Nancy his mother is living in a facility who doesn't allow visitors unless they're family, meaning she's either got dementia or she's mentally ill. Either way, where's our heroine going next? You guessed it, this place, Larkspur Lane Sanitarium. It's so weird to see Nancy, Nick, and George break in because it appears the door they entered through is sealed from the other side. Keep that in mind, because it's going to make it quite obvious that they broke in, and it'll come into play later. Also, George, what is this walk? The gang very quickly decides to split up, and George makes a reference to Nancy's solo career. A funny nod since we've never even seen her work alone on any case at this point. Just been told by everyone. Gotta love that tell, don't show rule.
Please don't say I'm the distraction.
You're the distraction.
How did you ever have a solo career?
This episode has about three different storylines all running at the same time, and none of them really connect to each other. Bess is visiting with what seems to be a lesbian woman that her aunt approves of and has set her up with. They somehow have nearly the same hairstyles without even meeting. I'm not quite sure of this choice for Bess, and even the outfit, though she is a Marvin, but seems so unlike Bess. She loves fashion, and I don't feel like this is something that she would wear. The woman she's eating with, Amya, I'm probably pronouncing that horribly wrong, apparently double booked their lunch for a business meeting with some possible male colleagues to help teach Bess about similar business dealings with her own family. The whole storyline seems pointless to the overall plot besides to introduce yet another love triangle, once again taking away from the main plot. The two later show up in a scene at Ryan's office, sharing a random and heartfelt moment as Amya helps her be a better Marvin and businesswoman, and Bess helps Amya be a better human.
Now, I might not know a lot about the business world, but I do know about being a human. My guess is that that cocktail ring is a gift from someone you hate because they hurt you.
It's an odd and very brief interaction. I'm not really quite sure why this was in the storyline at all. Seems like pointless filler to me. Sorry, Bess, but the writers have done you dirty. Either way, Bess provides a somewhat killer speech to Ryan about helping Carson, and Bess can promise the Marvins help later, which is so odd to me given the family's history and rivalry still being so fresh, and Bess is barely even a Marvin yet. How can she promise anything on their behalf? Interesting writing voice, but hey, girl power, I guess. Midway through the episode, we're introduced to our third and final plot point of the episode. The Hudsons have decided to put a hit out on Carson while he's in jail. Ace first goes to Ryan on Carson's behalf, Not Nancy for some reason. I don't understand the writer's choice of making this the third plot point, because it could have been utilized for a whole episode, especially if Nancy was available to focus on this storyline and be the one available for Carson. Why is Ace so invested in helping Mr. Drew? There's barely that close of a friendship established with him and Nancy, let alone any closeness Ace might have with Carson, aside from being a good guy and somewhat friend of Nancy's. More like co-worker, though. I don't see how this closeness is brought in so quickly. So, Super Hacker Ace manages to get into the police records and organize Carson's transfer to another facility, manages to get his hands on the appropriate vehicle, an outfit, and an ID, all in less than a day. I guess Nancy isn't the show's only super genius. Ace busts Carson out of jail to take him home? He takes him home, where the police obviously find him. So remind me again the premise of this plot again? But it all proves to work out in the end, because Ace's original plan ended up panning out as Ryan somehow tells the judge something to help release Carson from prison altogether. It's unclear and not well concluded in this episode, in my opinion, but hey, Carson is no longer in jail and he's not dead. So it's a win-win. Back at the sanitarium, Nancy manages to sneak into the records room without being detected whatsoever, even with limited guarding skills from Nick. Once getting her hands on Miss Dodd's records, she goes looking for her room, only to encounter, you guessed it, more ghosts. I don't understand these scare choices at this point. They're just annoying to me, honestly. Caught by one of the guards, Nancy is being redirected by him when he mentions the place is being haunted. Of course it is. The guard tells Nancy the place has been experiencing some ghostly things since the night Nancy and her friends held their seance for Lucy. Huh, go figure. And not only that, but the incidents were happening from the wing that they had sealed off until Nancy and her friends broke in. Of course. Finally, Nancy meets up with Lucy's mother to be met with riddles, as Patrice is stuck in the time her daughter died, her memory only of that time even causing her to first mistake Nancy for her mother, Kate. Patrice offers up very little info, but talks about a key she hid to Lucy's secrets. She says no one will ever find it, and then immediately offers a hint, saying,
someplace? No one will ever find it in the thin man's book.
Whatever that means. She concludes their conversation with a riddle as she kicks Nancy out of her room, where she runs back into Nick and George. Nick immediately tells her the phrases from the Bible and likely where the key has been hidden. The group quickly connect this Bible to the spirit that has been haunting the sanitarium, named Mr. Roper, a man and his family who died within their house back in the late 1800s, in what the guards called the Whisper Box. I don't understand if this is an actual box or just a name for the room within the sealed-off wing, but the group conclude the answers and the Bible must be there. Nancy, of course, takes off by herself, leaving Nick and George with their helpful guard friend. Suddenly something comes in over the radio, but sounds like workers from the facility searching the building for Nancy and her friends. Sal takes it upon himself to pull the fire alarm and causes things to get worse. When they all start leaving the building because of the alarms, Sal is caught and revealed to just be a patient who stole a worker's uniform and began impersonating one. Now, of course, it being too late for George and Nick to turn back, Nancy is on her own. And not in good shape, I might add. After a quick inspection of the room, roaches begin to infest her space and whispers are heard throughout the room, before ending the episode as Nancy falls to the ground, becoming unconscious, only to wake up in her bed at her home. But this isn't her home. Episode 13 serves as another filler episode, which doesn't do all that much in pushing the main plot forward, but instead diverting our attention to Nancy and her mother's relationship by exploring what Nancy's life could have been if her mother had never gotten sick or passed away. It also serves as one of the only episodes which the opening scene isn't in the claw, the conclusion appearing to be the entire town is a lot happier. With the addition of Kate back into the storyline, everything seems so sunshine and roses, and all of the main characters are very happy and chummy, but none of the romances are established, as Nick is unencumbered enough in this reality to have flirty time with Nancy again. But first, the new intros. So first, it seems Nancy is a real estate agent or something, because her meeting with Nick is to discuss buying a property with the money he came into recently. The two are immediately interrupted by the whole crew, now Bestie quickly going in for a hug. Very weird to see her in this reality, much closer to Nancy than George, but I guess it fits in this opposite theme. Now she has taken on a much more Best personality. She's now much bubblier, lighter, and happier, but a relationship is already established with her and Nick in a reality of sorts. I'll let George explain it.
Yeah, so we have a history.
There was one date. Well, half a date. Total disaster. His fault.
So... yeah, okay. Bess is still super zen, spiritual, and living in her van life, but now with the modern era, she's turned her lifestyle into a brand for social media. This aspect of Bess's personality, I actually believe. Not necessarily the flower child look in personality, but I could totally see Bess wanting to become a social media influencer, especially when it comes to her love for fashion. No real changes are made to Ace's character in this reality, as he's again established to be the meh character around, which I really disapprove of on the writer's part. I actually really loved Ace's character, and I would have heavily utilized him if I was one of the writers on the show. Throughout the beginning of the episode, Nancy is acting as if things are normal, and she's within the same universe she's always been in. It's not until the fire alarm randomly goes off at the claw that she suddenly realizes something is up. Her locket is missing, and shit is sideways. Nancy then spends a short amount of her time trying to convince her friends, or the fragments of her imagination, that they're not real, and they're just thinking she's totally cray. It's not until Nancy recalls the last place she remembers being that fake Nick tells us that he actually just bought that house, which in the normal reality is now the sanitarium. Nick and Nancy visit the house, and to me, it looks nothing like the sanitarium. Nancy recalls it looking familiar, but I don't believe it. This has to be a completely different area, and of course it must be the wing that we didn't explore much of, because this looks nothing like the shots we've seen before. I don't believe it, though. This place looks completely different than I remember in the last show. The interior shots of both buildings look nothing alike, but okay, we'll just go with it. The two finally make it to the attic where the familiar door to the whisper box is found, and Nancy immediately thinks this is her way back to her body. Then we get an actual ghost scare. Ugh! When the spirit disappears, a ruin is left on the floor of the attic, the same ruin Nancy seen before she passed out and woke up in this alternate reality. Back in the A1 reality, Nick and George get info from Sal, who was proven to be a patient, and unclear how mentally well he is in the last episode, but now appears to be the two's only hope to saving Nancy. Okay, seems believable. Nick called Bess and Ace looking for holy water, which they'll need to try and purify the room and save Nancy somehow. We then get a quick scene of the two in a car in a back alley getting a vial of holy water, like it's some illegal street drugs from a priest, who appears and disappears faster than a man who's heard the cops coming. Immediately after this scene, the group rally together with Sal, their new friend, and somehow manage to sneak back into the building, into the most restricted part of the facility. Yeah, okay, it totally makes sense, doesn't it? When they get to Nancy, they attempt to try and remove her from the room, but she begins foaming from the mouth and starts to suffocate, indicating she can't leave until her soul has been returned. On the mission in A2 reality, Nick and Nancy go to see Mr. Ryan Hudson, the previous owner of the house in this reality, and who now appears to run the town, I guess? Upon meeting up with Ryan, we get a secret of the old clock reference when he starts referring to his past and a fake will mystery that Nancy solved for him. He tells the two that Nancy said she hid the room key from the atrocities of his family on the other side. Weird choice to add this into the story, but okay. Nancy, of course, not knowing where she hid the key, has to have Ryan recite a couple of her own riddles to once again help her find the key. Even if this is a fake reality, everyone seems to just be going along with the whole Nancy has no memory thing pretty well. Ryan doesn't even flinch when giving this info to Nancy.
12 steps from the sweet angel. Take a right at the farmer's wife under the shadow of both devoted grandparents. Find the belly of the hollow oak.
The riddle then leads the crew to the cemetery. Before we get there, we get a moment between Nancy and her mother as she gets a call from the doctor. But in this reality, she's completely fine. An interesting twist to experiment with, but the fact that this is only done for one episode and quickly wrapped up just seems to lack weight and any real connection for me, but it was nice to see Kate back around for a bit. Nick arrives to pick up Nancy for their cemetery date, but guys, it's raining, so what do we do when it's wet outside? We make it wet. Okay, I'm sorry, yeah, but anyway, we get another Nancy and Nick sex scene, of course. I thought we were getting away from that. You thought we were getting away from it. Newsflash, friends, there is no escape from it. The funniest part of the episode is the editing through the sex scene. They juxtapose Nancy and Nick's sex scene with all of her friends crying and worrying over her dying. When I watched this scene, I practically died laughing. What was this editing choice here? Either way, I find it humorous. As if to add more humor to the scene, we get a post-coitus shot of pieces of paper falling from the sky, words from her friends in the A1 reality seeping through and trying to reach her. I found this to be a very weird choice on the writer's part. The voices would have done fine and added a bit more personal weight, I feel, if Nancy could just hear them. As it was when I first saw the letters, I was more confused than anything, but it ends up tying in a bit later, so it's not that bad. Finally, we get to the cemetery, and the gang finds the key hidden in a tree close to all of the clues Nancy had left for herself, but not before another fun jump scare. Yeah, don't we love these? I really hope all of this comes to mean something later on, but I have very little faith. The symbol will be explained to a point, but not necessarily enough in this season, I feel, for the mentions it gets moving forward. With the key in hand, the group returns to the house on Larkspur Lane, Nancy leaving the figments of her imagination with a super emotional and unnecessary goodbye, I feel. But I think it's more for Nancy to say goodbye to her relationship with Nick, because up until that point, she had somewhat been holding on to it, and having their last sexy time in this reality serving as the end to their chapter for her. Nancy opens the door and nothing. The room is empty. Nancy decides to sort through the letters from her friends, hoping for a sign. When talking a bit with her mother, she's reminded of the letter Carson said her mother had written to her and a map to heaven, so when Nancy passed, she'd be able to find her. Nancy snatches the letter, and the next clue is a star she needs to find. But the sky is too cloudy to see any stars, and before that, she remembers that she has stars on her bedroom ceiling. Finding the stars above her, it leads to her closet, but before she can go through, Kate enters the scene once again, and now we and Nancy get our fond farewell to Kate Drew, something Nancy wanted more than anything, but felt cheated out by her mother and father. In this reality, though technically just her imagination, Nancy closes the chapter on this book as well and gets a little more closure when it comes to Kate's death and the absence she left in Nancy's life. A sweet message, I believe, but once again I feel it's a bit lost because the relationship between Kate and Nancy doesn't feel like it's been built on enough and not deep enough to have the emotions we're supposed to feel when watching this scene. I personally felt a bit hollow about it, because I feel we didn't get enough previous setup and exposition on Nancy as a person, her life, and her relationships with Nancy and Carson. She's here to sedate some of our wonders, but gone from the story all too quickly. If her character had been fleshed out more and we got to see her career and relationships with other people within the town, and even Carson and Nancy, it might have made more sense to have this emotional goodbye, and it would have hit a little harder than it did. That's my opinion, of course. Finally being back in the A1 reality, everyone returns to the claw for a quick powwow, just in time for Nancy to show some more jealousy and longing towards Nick when she sees him with George. Apparently trying to get over her feelings, however, always going to have some longing. Upon returning home, Nancy finally gets to see Carson back for the first time, seeing as she's been MIA for the entire time he's been released from prison. Carson speaks with Nancy about needing to do some volunteer work moving forward, as he'll be off work and instead working on building his own defense case against Lucy's murder. Remembering Carson in the A2 reality was so involved in the historical society, Nancy randomly mentions it as if she's never been, doesn't know, or remember anything about it. Only for Carson to reveal to Nancy that she was actually the one growing up who loved the historical society and used to chum around with the librarian there. Nancy immediately recognizing the symbol she's been seeing to be pieces of the symbols from the historical society's logo. Not wasting any time to even sleep after a near-death experience, Nancy immediately takes off, showing up at the building at what looks like the middle of the night, and the woman there, Hannah Gruen, yeah, I know what you're thinking, but trust me, she's not even close to the same one, sadly. I guess she doesn't seem to mind people showing up in the middle of the night. Hannah tells Nancy the key she has is to a lockbox that belonged to Tiffany Hudson. How the key got into the sanitarium, your guess is as good as mine. Within the box is a video file of Tiffany speaking to Hannah Gruen about being haunted. Hannah says she's a keeper of sorts. It remains unclear how she actually helps people at this point, but according to her, the video is the last time she saw Tiffany and reveals that Tiffany was in fact being haunted by Lucy for some reason as well. And in Hannah's own words,
I believe Tiffany got too close to the truth.
The truth about what?
Someone didn't want her to solve Lucy Sable's murder.
Don't forget that, okay? Heading back to our claw-themed intro, episode 14 begins with our characters opening up the restaurant for the day, with a new and interesting addition to the staff. Patrice, apparently escaping from the sanitarium in one of the previous two episodes, has suddenly shown up to work at the claw. According to my research, she used to work there up until the Hudsons worked to get her fired as a punishment for her daughter dating their son behind their back. Anyways, the crew try their best to pretend Miss Dodd isn't around, but proves difficult when Nancy brings out her mystery conspiracy board, where Miss Dodd's late daughter is at the center of it. Also, this episode serves as the return of Laura Tandy. Oh yeah, remember her? You know, she's been in a coma for a while now, and there's been no mention of her by anyone, and nothing even from her apparent boyfriend Ace, who clearly never took the time to visit her because he was too busy chilling with the Clue crew and becoming chummy chum with Carson. Boyfriend of the year, ladies, am I right? Anyways, Laura is back, and in her words, she's better than ever, nearly embracing A2 Bess's zen behavior, no longer encumbered by her hatred towards the Hudsons and the police. Well,
after our near-death experience, I realized I was carrying around so much anger and negativity in my life. Life's too short. I wanna open myself to the beautiful and positive possibilities all around us.
Seriously, who is this woman? Laura quickly dumps on us further exposition on the Tiffany murder case that hasn't been addressed for a good couple of episodes now, so thank God for her. With her death finally being ruled a murder and Laura's name apparently being cleared, she is now close to closing in on her sister's inheritance and plans to use all of it to start her new life in Paris, where she wants Ace to join her, so they can continue their lives and romance together. Quite an impulsive decision for someone who just got out of a coma. Do we need to call up the doctor to assess for brain damage here? She's very quick to make this decision, and I don't understand the writer's choice in it, now trying to rush this character out the door. Not to mention the fact that she just got off of being a murder suspect and she's choosing to skip town. I feel the police should think this is sus. She served as a wonderful new addition to the cast in my opinion, but with the show's very quick forward motion with its plot, it appears there's no time or room for Laura, so she's got to go. But not before joining us in this episode as her final send-off. Nick heads out to rally up Josh Dodd to have him come and pick up his mother, and we finally get at least one real and meaningful interaction between these two, the first time in this entire series. I remember the first time watching this and almost forgetting that Nick works for Josh, because up until this point, these two characters rarely shared any words between each other. Their relationship was left completely vague and nearly non-existent from my perspective. Josh arrives at the Claw, posts another jump scare, very confused as to what's going on, before leaving and taking Patrice away with him. When the two have finally left, Laura now begins talking about not wanting to join the Clue crew, but instead wanting to take Ace out of it, but gets convinced by our heroine. Because, of course, who could resist?
Hey, you know what is so romantic? Solving a homicide together. With me.
Bringing Laura proves to be essential, as it's her as the next of kin that can request access to her sister's device for GPS locations as to where she went prior to her death. Sassy Nancy eliminates Officer Karen with her words, making me surprised how they're all still even allowed in the precinct after all their constant disrespect and rudeness towards the police officers.
You always said Lucy's case file didn't have the answers to what happened, so we're trying a new angle. Right this way.
Though Nancy has some bias against Karen, and later for good reason, to mistreat her at this point as she is an officer of the law, it surprises me, and I would think a typical respect is what you would expect when dealing with these officials. However, this show completely dismisses them, and instead their characters talk to police officers as if they're just any Joe Blow off the street. Doesn't suit my liking too much, but it's the narrative they want to spin, so it's their world and we're just living in it. With Tiffany's GPS locations, the crew immediately deduces that Tiffany's track locations aren't fully accurate, given she would likely be trying to cover her tracks from the Hudsons while she's investigating the Lucy murder. I don't recall it being mentioned as to how or why Tiffany chose to become a detective on her own for this case, but it almost sounds like her character personality was modeled after Kate and Nancy, as it's explained many times that Tiffany also loved puzzles. Deducing that Tiffany left her phone at locations near where she was really choosing to go, Nancy figures one of the locations she chose to go to was the local library. Ace immediately refusing to go with her.
Let's go.
I'm not going to the library.
What? Why?
I have enemies there.
Geez, did this man forget to return some books, or what are we talking here? I can't remember if or when it's really explained as to why Ace has enemies at the library, but it's likely related to him and his hacking skills, but it must have also occurred whenever Ace's mother was working there. However, no info was really provided on where Ace's mother is now, but she is said to have worked at the library when Ace was young. While still in the library together, Ace hacks into Tiffany's search history and emails that she got, and ends up finding she was looking over an email chain from Ryan and Lucy from before she died. It's unclear how Tiffany even got access to these emails in the first place. I mean, coming from Ace, it would have been more likely given that he's a hacker. Unless Ryan had the same email forever and just happened to keep these emails and she found them that way, otherwise it just seems seriously unlikely. The emails between the two show their romance that blossomed over time, until suddenly there's one that just doesn't seem to be from Ryan. I remember first seeing this and immediately thinking that likely someone had hacked into his email, sending a message to Lucy on his behalf. The message quite obviously sticking out from the others, and given the way his family behaves and handles things, everyone is quick to assume this message came from Ryan, furthering the idea that he had killed Lucy or at least knew about it. To me, it seemed a bit odd that they immediately thought it was Ryan who had sent this message, given that it was so out of place when compared to all the other messages the two had been going back and forth with. But when bringing all of the evidence back to the crew, Laura very quickly sheds her new Zen ways and is back on the team. I hate the Hudsons.
Wait, so Ryan is responsible for the death of two women and he's still walking around free? Screw being Zen. Let's bring the bastard down.
Nancy and the group agree, thinking the best approach is to invite Officer Hart to the Claw along with Ryan Hudson to try and recreate that night of the murder, hoping they can use that to help figure out what happened to Tiffany. I find this a very weird and pointless way for Nancy to later come to the conclusion that the poison was planted by someone who was listening in on the meeting and Ryan Hudson's order, this finally bringing forth the idea that Tiffany wasn't the intended murder victim at all. Instead, it was Ryan, and Tiffany merely got the poison salad by mistake.
I used that salad for Tiffany's entree.
Funnily enough, Ryan is the only one who doesn't quite understand what happened until the teenagers lay it all out for him. I know he's supposed to be some dumb, rich guy, but come on. Finally realizing what had happened, Ryan is immediately prepared to defend himself. An obvious choice when you find out you're trying to be murdered. But his nonchalantness about his wife being murdered in general, and then finding out she's been murdered because of him, even if you were no longer in love, comes across as very odd and cold to me for his character. Once again, the discovery of how the poison was even placed and how they knew it was for Ryan, once again goes to Detective Ghost Lucy. It drives me nuts how they have these moments of trying to make Nancy a super genius, but then have these other moments of taking the honor completely away and giving the discovery to some supernatural element instead. It just doesn't make sense. I've said it once and I will say it again. Adding the supernatural element was a poor choice in my mind, especially adding the realism element to it. Once Ryan decides to flee the scene, scared away by Ghost Lucy, Nancy re-enters the claw and receives the triangulated coordinates of where Lucy had been sending her emails with Ryan. Ironically enough, it brings Nancy to an old computer at Josh Dodd's mechanic shop, which used to be his father's when he was growing up. I'm surprised why the writers chose to have Nancy break in, as it seems Josh is home and she could have very well just asked him to come in. At this point, she has no reason to be suspicious of him for anything, so it just doesn't make sense to me. Nancy quickly realizes that since Josh is still using the computer, he has seen all of the emails from that specific chain, meaning he's known for a very long time about Lucy and Ryan's relationship, and the emails that followed. For some reason, he then immediately opens up to Nancy about his hatred for Ryan because of the relationship drama he witnessed between Lucy and Ryan in his youth. Josh then decides to lay out his entire diabolical plan to Nancy, not even trying to hide what he'd done, weirdly enough, when trying to get his revenge on Ryan. Nancy then realizing that Tiffany wasn't actually being followed by anybody, but only feeling she was because Josh was trying to follow Ryan instead. Nancy then laid out in her head what she believed had happened that night. Although it didn't seem all that possible to me, given how many people were at the claw that night and how no one happened to see him. But once she finished the story, Josh immediately rushed at her in an attempt to kill her and silence her from telling anyone the truth, swinging at her only to miss cutting an electrical wire in the process. The two having a small struggle before Nancy pushes Josh back, causing him to get stuck somehow on a random chain hook hanging from the ceiling in the shop. He then walks into a puddle, and like in a Final Destination movie, all the perfectly synced things happen before he's electrocuted to the point of frying his flesh. This death was actually quite insane in my opinion, and I was not expecting it at all. It was very obviously brutal and quite traumatizing for Nancy. The police are immediately alerted, and once they arrive at the scene to collect the body of Josh Dodd, they notice it's gone. As if he just got up and walked away. But after a shock like that, how? I don't understand. This is another part of the show that has me lost. How is this even possible? Laura and Ace also finally share their goodbyes as he decides not to join her in Paris, inevitably ending their relationship and our time with Laura Tandy. Quite a sad and I feel very rushed goodbye for this character, but as it's already been presented many times in the show, the writers value massive plot development and continuous rush forward motion of the story versus taking time for character development and genuine relationships and interactions. The fact that Laura's character came back in this episode in such a fun way, I feel added some life to the story, but then to just immediately leave, never to return by the end of the episode, was quite disappointing in my opinion.